Hello there! Welcome to the Saroy channel, wherever you are in the world. So much love to each and every one of you. I do hope you're doing remarkably well. I'm doing great, thank you very much, and I'm so thrilled you've joined me for part four of our story tonight. But before we continue, don't forget to subscribe to the channel, click the notification bell and the thumbs up, and let's continue with the final part of our story. It was wonderful having my son living at home with me, commuting to his job every morning. I noticed that June kept herself to herself, avoided me like the plague, you could say, because if we got talking for long enough, we usually ended up tearing each other apart with our unkind words. I dare say she was clandestinely thinking that I was the mother-in-law from hell. In truth, I probably was. I don't exactly wear that badge of honour with any pride. I keep telling myself June's carrying my grandchild in her womb. And if I do anything to upset the woman too much, she and my son just might move away. And I would absolutely hate that to happen. My friends all thought I should be deliriously happy having June floating around the house with a grandchild on the way. But I have felt nothing but disdain towards her. June was introduced to my girlfriends over a lunch event that I invited her to attend. They all thought she was absolutely wonderful, and I was being unreasonable to judge her so harshly. They are not wearing my shoes, are they? They don't know what it's like to have the person you love more than life itself, which in my case is my son Justin, giving someone else their undivided attention and devotion. So yes, I'm rather jealous about my daughter-in-law. I can't help myself. Things changed, of course, when I realized June was getting up early in the morning, after Justin had left for work to perform her yoga exercises on the beach. Honestly, what is that woman thinking? Goodness gracious me, she's pregnant. Justin left the house when it was still dark because he's always been an early bird like that. He enjoys arriving at work very promptly. I would hear June shuffling around in her bedroom rather awkwardly after he left. I was a light sleeper. I always liked to get up myself to give my son a coffee for the road. Mum, you don't have to get up on my account. Why don't you go back to bed and have a sleep in? He would say rather indignantly. Oh, but I would insist. I don't want you going onto the road without a coffee and a little snack in your stomach. You need something, love, before you go. Mum, you're the best, Justin would say, throwing his arms around me with a big hug. What would I do without you? I'm sure you would survive, I would tease. After Justin left for work every morning, June would predictably get dressed in some yoga leggings and with her yoga mat in hand would nonchalantly swan off to the beach to do some of her yoga poses under a dark, looming sky, while she waited for the sun to rise. Honestly, what was that woman thinking? Sometimes I despair, wondering what is going on in that head of hers. This daughter-in-law of mine seems determined to ruffle my feathers at every turn, even though she has no idea she's actually doing it to me. I was now concerned about June's safety, which aggrieved me slightly because I didn't want to be concerned about her in any way. But I couldn't stop myself from worrying. I mean, I knew what could potentially be out there on that beach in the early hours of the morning, when darkness still reigned supreme. I realized if anything were to happen to June, then my grandbaby could be in serious trouble, and the idea of becoming a doting grandmother was beginning to appeal to me rather. Although I've never admitted as much to June, I've feigned very little interest in the baby growing inside of her. I was already preparing a nursery for the baby, although June knows nothing about this grand gesture of generosity of mine, which I would later reveal to her when my grandbaby was closer to being born. Let's just say I wanted to make it as difficult as possible for my son Justin to want to leave home, now that he and his wife have moved in with me. I just adore having him back under my roof again. June, I said to her, where are you going and what on earth are you doing? Do you realize how early it is in the morning? It is still dark outside. What are you doing with a yoga mat in your hand? Honestly, you can't go out at this time of the morning. Are you kidding me or what? I'm an early riser, she told me. I can't get back to sleep after Justin leaves for work. I'll just remain in bed, tossing and turning, and I don't want that. I always got up early in Bloomington, you know. I did my yoga on the front balcony while it was still dark outside. Let me tell you, this is the best time of the morning to do my exercises. I take a torch with me. I do them in the dark until the sun rises. It's spectacularly beautiful to watch the sun rise and to see the waves crashing and washing over the sand. And when the sunlight glitters over the water, it is beautiful to behold. I find the experience soulfully invigorating. Well, that's the maybe, and I'm sure it is very invigorating, June. But can you not do your exercises in your bedroom, perhaps, if you can't get back to sleep? It's not a good idea for a pregnant woman like yourself to be wandering around in the dark on the beach. You are a pregnant woman. You have a responsibility to the baby you're carrying inside you, for goodness sake. You need to take care of yourself and the baby. Since when did you care about the baby or about me? Said June, making a face. I would have thought you'd be happy to get rid of me. You've made it perfectly clear you don't enjoy me being around and that I'm not good enough for your son. So I'd think you'd be glad if I was abducted by aliens or something untoward was about to happen to me. Don't be ridiculous, June. Honestly, you are talking absolute nonsense. For your information, I do actually care about you. I may not be good at showing it, but I do. And I'm very concerned about your well-being. And don't forget, you're also carrying my grandbaby inside of you. I've got a duty of responsibility towards you and the baby. Does Justin know you go out to do yoga at this absurd time of the morning on the beach? I bet you he doesn't. And I've got a feeling he wouldn't be best pleased if he knew about it. No, he doesn't know. And I would appreciate, Jackie, if you didn't tell him. Because like you, he'd probably go on and on about it not being safe. And that's ridiculous. The beach is perfectly safe. Besides, I can take care of myself, Jackie, she said, looking rather annoyed. It won't be long before the sun comes up. And don't worry, I'm not going to be abducted by little green men. I was just toying with you when I said that. June, cluelessly and very naively, in her callow ignorance, had absolutely no idea that abduction was the very thing I was concerning myself with. She was making a nonchalant joke about this, about the possibility of being abducted, because she had no clue what I knew could potentially be out there on that beach, especially when it was dark as it was right now. June, I said, unable to disguise the rising panic in my voice. I don't think it's a great idea going out onto the beach at this time of the morning. It's still incredibly dark out there, and it's not safe. Anything could be out there. And you're right. Justin would not be remotely happy about this. Why don't you wait for a sensible hour of the morning, when it gets lighter, when regular dog walkers and runners are up and about taking their morning exercise? That would be so much more advisable. Better for you, I think. Look, Jackie, you mean well, I'm sure you do, but I can look after myself. I rarely enjoy doing my yoga on the beach at this time of the morning. There's no other time like it. I do not want to be doing my yoga in front of passing dog walkers and runners. This is my special time, if you know what I mean, to be with nature and to enjoy the privacy and the space. I'll see you when I get back, she said. And by the way, Jackie, thanks for caring. I really didn't think you did. She gave me a warm smile that seemed quite genuine, actually. I was rather taken aback. I managed a half-hearted smile in return. Despite my very best efforts to discourage June, the infuriating woman paid me no heed and simply marched out of the door and left me wondering what I should do to prevent her from taking her morning exercises out of doors. If she continued this way, things could potentially become grievously dangerous. But June was blindly oblivious to this. My God, Justin certainly knew how to pick his woman. I knew what could be on the beach at this time of the morning. I'd seen her before, and I was concerned about what she might do if she was to observe June with her own eyes. There was something wrong with that creature. Its head was very oddly shaped, as if she was mentally impaired or retarded in some way. I was worried about June. As a threat on the beach, I had never told anybody about before, for fear of being ridiculed, of course. But the fear was very real, and it was a female Bigfoot. This creature was likely to be around in the early hours of the morning, but I had encountered her myself, and never have I been so terrified in all of my life as I was on that particular encounter, which I was sure would end up with me breathing my very last. So naturally, I was very concerned about June. Maybe the thing was long gone, but you can never be sure of these things, can you? It happened about 2 years prior, well, my experience, on the anniversary of my husband's death. You know what it's like on precious anniversaries. It makes you become gooey with sentimentality, so much so that you would make a chocolate molten cake almost seem hard. At the time, I was feeling so desperately sad, so sorry for myself. So many people naively believe that when you lose a beloved loved one, that you move on with your life seamlessly, and things get easier along the way. But in my experience, they never really do. I hide my pain extremely well, of course, because I've always been a privately reserved person, and I keep check of my emotions all the time. Every year on the anniversary of my husband's death, I quite literally fall apart. I pretend to Justin and all my close friends that I've come to terms with my husband's passing. But it's a bare-faced lie. Nothing could be further from the truth. But I like to maintain an air of being strong and in control and having my life together. But as June was quick to point out, image for me is everything. It always has been. And I need to change that about myself. Ostensibly, I knew when Buzzard was taking a tiny aeroplane with some high-profile entrepreneurs for a business conference that it was a very bad idea. I've never felt good about tiny planes. And when the plane came down, killing all 5 passengers on board, I can't say it came as a complete surprise to me. Deep down in my gut, I knew something bad would happen to my husband, as before his death I'd been plagued with nightmares, where my husband's decapitated head would come rolling towards me. At first I thought someone was kicking a ball towards me in my dream on the beach, but when I bent down to see the decapitated head, I realized it belonged to my husband. I would wake up screaming, and my husband would comfort me, telling me I had nothing to worry about. Of course, I never told Buzzard the details of my dream, because I just couldn't tell him. I did tell my girlfriends, of course, who told me not to worry about it because it was a gory dream, and perhaps I'd seen something macabre on television that had influenced my dream state. I so wanted to believe what they were saying is true, but the feeling of impending doom hung over me for several weeks. And when my husband took that plane trip, I begged him not to go. I don't like you taking a tiny plane. I don't have a good feeling about this. Please don't go. Can't you pretend to be sick or something? My husband had laughed at me, taken me lovingly into his arms, and said, "I'm going to be just fine, Jackie. That plane's been used dozens of times by the company. It's perfectly safe, I can assure you of that." Well, needless to say, the plane was located on the sprawling Canadian wilderness. It was in tatters. Everybody had died tragically, and my husband's head was found separated from his body. So yes, dreams, I believe, can be prognostic. So it was on the anniversary of Buzzard's death, about 2 years ago. I had woken up in bed very early, given myself a couple of stiff brandies to help me get through the next 24 hours, so I thought. I'm not exactly a big drinker, never have been, really. But I knew the brandy would numb the vacuous emptiness inside me. I couldn't help it because I was arrested by an all-consuming grief. And even though my son Justin has never seen me like this, crying like I was, I completely soaked my pillows with my tears. I'd never normally go out on a stroll on the beach while it was still dark. But goodness gracious, after a couple of brandies early in the morning, I suddenly felt rather energized. And taking a stroll on the beach seemed like a great idea. It's amazing how many things seem like a great idea when you've become a little tiddly. Besides, a walk is always good when you're down in the dumps. This is something my grief counsellor advocated. Take a walk, Jackie, he would say, if you need to lift your spirits. It's the best advice I can offer you. It works for everyone I know. Unlike June, in a more sober frame of mind, I'd have never undertaken a walk on the beach while it was still dark outside, because I'm much more responsible than that girl. But it's amazing how your inhibitions can just float away when you've got a couple of stiff drinks inside of you. I was rather inebriated, I will say this about myself, as I walked down the beach, not exactly in a straight line. I had a flashlight in my hand. It was about 4 o'clock in the morning, I would say. That was when I saw the Bigfoot. It was dark, so I sensed a presence around me. I observed this big black hulking silhouette, basking there in the moonlight, as if soaking up the moon's energy. I remember stopping short in my tracks and saying, "What the hell is that?" In my slightly bladdered state, I thought I was delusional, and I began to giggle, because I thought it was all hilariously funny that I was visualizing this thing that wasn't there. But then I realized that it was, and that this thing was actually real. The Bigfoot was staring at me, excitedly, through dark, spirited eyes, like a kid looking at a puppy dog he wants desperately to bring home with him. I remember when my flashlight illuminated her under the inky sky. I knew at once she was female. Her breasts were saggy, and very visible beneath the thatch of thick, slightly tangled-looking hair. I had a profound sense of absolute knowing that this female Bigfoot wanted to abduct me. How I knew this was by the childlike, enamoured but rather bedazzled look she entertained on her face when she looked at me, that I could read rather like a book, and it gave me cause for alarm. The female Bigfoot was looking at me as if I was a toy she wanted to grab and play with like a doll. I sensed she wasn't right in the head, as if she was handicapped, retarded, or rather simple-minded. I'd say she was easily about 8 foot tall, extremely well-built, with a very human-looking face, on a very odd-shaped head that made her look very, very simple, as if she had the intellect of a 4-year-old child. She was covered in this dark hair, but smelt as briny as the sea itself. She was carrying a crab in her hands, but she dropped it onto the beach casually, and it happily scuttled away. The next thing I knew is the Bigfoot let out a loud, excited squeak, and then began to give me chase, running after me in delight, like a kid running after crabs in the sea sand. She sounded like a child, happily chasing after a kite. I may have been slightly wasted, but sensing danger in the air, my legs began to almost vibrate beneath me, and my body seemed to gain momentum rather magically. In that adrenal response, rather like a plane in takeoff, I ran like I have never run before or since. And somehow, my alcoholic intoxication seemed to pass me by. As I focused on escaping this thing, I knew the Bigfoot would catch me. There was no doubt about that in my mind. I don't think I've ever felt so much fear. My life seemed to flash before me, as if I sensed I was living on borrowed time. I could feel her raspy breath on my back, and then she grabbed me. I found myself looking into her dark, excited eyes. She began touching my face, running her hands down my skin with an expression of total awe, as if she thought I was the most precious, beautiful doll she'd ever seen. I stared into her eyes, and I was terrified. And then she was about to throw me on her back, when I heard this booming voice in the darkness. Makilanita! Ambali! Someone appeared to be calling her. I guess it was one of her kind. She let go of me, looking bitterly disappointed, and then ran across the beach towards the voice, and was gone. In the distance, against some tall, lofty trees that fringed the edge of the woods that stretched down at the far corner of the beach, I saw two prominent black silhouettes. I knew at once they were Bigfoots. They seemed to guide the female away. I realized I'd had an awfully lucky escape, for I had no idea what this female Bigfoot could have potentially done to me. I was naturally very concerned about June going out onto the beach this early in the morning. What if she was to encounter the same creature that I did? So I knew I would discreetly have to follow her. There was no choice in the matter. I'd have to do it. I armed myself with some pepper spray in the hope that should this female Bigfoot appear on the scene, I could spray her in the eyes to give June time to get away from her. How could I possibly tell my daughter-in-law? Oh, by the way, don't go out onto the beach because there's this weird Bigfoot that might just abduct you. How crazy would I sound if I were to tell her that? I have my reputation to consider. Most people don't believe these things are even real, but I know they are because of my very close encounter with the Bigfoot. So there I was on this early morning, dashing after my daughter-in-law, hoping that she wouldn't realize I was stalking her. I needed to see that she came to no harm, because not only was she carrying my grandbaby inside her, I knew that if anything untoward were to happen to her, Justin would never forgive me. I could almost hear him saying, "You let her go out onto the beach when it was still dark outside? Are you crazy, Mum?" Even if I assured him I'd tried to dissuade his mulishly stubborn wife, he would argue that I could have gone after her. "For God's sake, she's pregnant, Mum. Why didn't you watch over her, especially if it was still dark?" I felt a little apprehensive as a slight breeze whipped against my face. I could smell the salt in the air and practically taste it on my tongue. I knew the night would soon fade away, as light eventually broke through the inky firmament. And when it did, I would discreetly make my way back to the house. It was quite a light night with a full moon and a whole galaxy of bright stars, and with the moon reflecting its light over the water, and its prisms dancing over the ocean, in a reflectant silvery glaze, I was struck by how magnificently beautiful it was. It was made all the more magnificent by the rushing waves, galloping to the shore, like thousands of white stallions, racing through the water. I could see the light on the beach, and there was June doing a downward dog pose under the moon. It did look quite dramatic. I'm lucky that she was on a quiet, rocky part of the beach, so I ducked down behind a large rock to clandestinely watch over her, with my pepper spray at the ready. I did feel like a dreadful snoop, but I wasn't going to give June the satisfaction of knowing I was worried about her, as that would mean I actually cared, and I enjoyed being aloof towards her. Although this morning she seemed surprised that I was rather concerned about her welfare. I suddenly felt rather stupid hiding behind a rock, watching my daughter-in-law, like a perverted peeping Tom, as she seamlessly flowed into all manner of yoga poses. She was really good, surprisingly nimble. But dare I say, when she got more heavily pregnant, she'd no longer be able to perform half of these exercises. There was no way I was going to spend every morning watching over her while she performed her downward dog sequences. I would tell my son Justin when he returned home tonight that after he left for work every morning, his wife would sneakily go out onto the beach while it was dark outside to perform her yoga postures. I wouldn't be able to tell him about the Bigfoot I'd encountered 2 years prior. But I think what his wife was doing would alarm him enough, and he would prevent her from going out onto the beach while it was still dark. He certainly needed to put a stop to this idiosyncratic behavior of hers. Of course, if the truth be told, I didn't necessarily believe that the Bigfoot I had encountered 2 years prior would actually show up and make an appearance. But you can never be too sure about anything, can you? I could see the darkness slowly beginning to fade, and I felt relief as the sun slowly began to rise, and an injection of light seemed to pirouette through the dark veil. An orange sun peered over the horizon, dappling the water in wispers of dancing light. It was spectacular to witness, almost taking my breath away. I realized at this point June was meditating. She had her hands on her knees, her eyes were closed. She appeared to be humming to herself. I had no idea she enjoyed meditating. I was learning quite a lot about my daughter-in-law. My relief about the light stealing its way across the sky was short-lived, because the female Bigfoot I'd seen 2 years prior reappeared. She was standing there in bemusement, watching June meditating. I could hardly believe it. She was back again. I observed an animated, intrigued look appear on her face, a similar look that she'd shown me when I'd known she'd wanted to grab me. I genuinely felt this Bigfoot was very simple. She had the mind of a child. Like a little girl, she studied June, as if she was a Barbie doll that she wanted to take home to play with. Even if she meant June no harm, she was so huge, it would be nothing for her to break June's bones. She was pretty ungainly and obliviously unaware of her own strength. When she had chased me that day, I could see she had appeared clumsy on her feet. I was stuck between a rock and a hard place, not knowing what I should do, and the pepper canister in my hand seemed pretty useless. I was about to scream out to warn June to get away from the Bigfoot, because it was stealthily moving towards her, but my voice seemed to be locked. Nothing came out of my mouth. My worst fears were confirmed when the Bigfoot grabbed June and threw her over her shoulders as if she was a sack of potatoes and began to run with June on her back down the beach. In that moment, I knew I cared about June more than I was actually prepared to admit. Maybe the girl was growing on me after all. Maybe I was rather fond of her. I was certain I was never going to see her again. I tried to scream as I ran after the Bigfoot, waving my pretty useless pepper canister in my hand, as if it could somehow save the day, rescue the moment, but there was no way it could. I was no match for this female Bigfoot. I staggered after her, feeling absolutely exhausted and worn out, but she vanished into the woods, disappearing from my sight. I helplessly collapsed onto the beach. Oh, I was exhausted, worn out, tired. I began to bawl my eyes out. What use would it be to call anyone for help? The Bigfoot would be long gone by now. I'd never ever see June again. And what would I say to my son, Justin? Could I ever tell him the truth about why his wife had disappeared into thin air? Would my son even buy that June, for no reason at all, had disappeared under my watch? And even if there were a police investigation into the matter, would they believe my preposterous account? Of course not. I couldn't tell them something like this. They'd probably think I belonged in a funny farm. Or in some way the mother-in-law from hell, who despised her daughter-in-law, had secretly disposed of her body in the ocean. Maybe they'd believe that. Would my son believe his mother was capable of such an atrocious evil? Would he ever be able to look me square in the face again? This was a hopeless situation. Who did I call for help in these bizarre circumstances? Help! Please help! My daughter-in-law's been abducted by a Bigfoot! Someone would probably think I was high on drugs or something like that. June's account. I couldn't believe it when my mother-in-law, Jackie, actually tried to stop me going out onto the beach that morning. For a moment, it actually seemed like the toffee-nosed woman actually cared about me. Maybe there was a heart in her after all. I hope she wouldn't blab to Justin about my morning regime. If Justin learnt I was doing yoga poses on a mat on the beach while it remained dark outside, he wouldn't be remotely amused by this. Justin would tell me to go onto the beach later in the morning, when the dog walkers and joggers were about, because it was likely much safer then. It was definitely safe out here, from what I'd gleaned. So what did I have to worry about? This was a special time to be alone with myself. And I loved more than anything in the world watching the sun rise while listening to the crashing waves. There was nothing quite like it. Ostensibly, if Jackie had her way, these trips to the beach of mine at this hour of the morning would be very short-lived, for my persuasive husband would possibly rein me in like a wild horse that needs to be tethered. Still, I was going to enjoy my yoga and meditation this morning, while I could. I was settled happily on my mat performing my poses. It felt so very good to stretch out my body and to stare up at a moonlit sky with a dazzling array of silvery stars with their jeweled faces shining down upon me. I needed to do these yoga exercises more than ever, as living with a cantankerous Jackie was far from easy for me. I didn't tell Justin about our regular disputes. I knew it would grievously upset him. He was so busy settling down into his new job, and if he knew his mother was giving me a hard time, it would be a source of great disquiet for him. These morning routines were helping me to centre myself, to remain calm throughout the rest of the day. I couldn't help but like Jackie, even though she was so damn pretentious and so full of herself. But I clandestinely suspected there was a softer side to her character, that she kept discreetly hidden from the rest of the world. Jackie was Justin's mother, after all, and if she'd brought him up to be such a charmer, she couldn't be all that bad, could she? She was probably very spoilt, used to having everything in life upholstered by grandeur. But I think she was beginning to see that life is about the little special moments you spend with loved ones. And while money has its distinct advantages, it certainly cannot fill up your soul with the richness that comes from those precious moments that no money on earth can buy. I was listening to a famous man recently on a podcast. I won't mention his name. He was saying he'd learnt that through his riches and fame, that inanimate things cannot make you happy. I thought that once I had everything my heart desired, that I had arrived in life, that I would now feel fulfilled, but I was still vacuously empty, even when I could have everything that money could possibly buy me. I soon realized happiness comes from within. I read people's comments that were scrolled down below. Everybody agreed with him. "Too right, man," wrote someone. "I was in that place, had more money than sense, gave it all away and went to India to spend time with the yogis. Best thing I ever did. I feel happy now. I'm satisfied with a lot less." Another person wrote, "I was so ambitious. I wanted to be a multi-millionaire many times over. Thought it would give me my heart's desires. When I finally accomplished my goal, I thought, what now? I realized nothing had changed. I was as empty as I'd always been." That was what I was trying to teach Jackie. So seeing her cooking with a Filipino cook one day made me realize she had taken on board some of my salient advice, although she'd never admit it, of course. She was far too proud for that. So there I was on the beach on my yoga mat, enjoying the morning's wrestling match, with the inky sky soon surrendering to the light's certain victory. The victorious light was now disturbing the horizon with its tangerine-like glow. How glad I was not to be in my bed. There was something so spiritual about being one with nature at this quintessential perfect moment. It was when I began to meditate that something extraordinary happened to me. I was lifted up into the air and thrown onto this hairy creature's back. Of course, at the time, I didn't realize this was happening. It was all so surreal. I actually thought it was part of my meditation. I was inwardly congratulating myself for what seemed to be like a real out-of-body experience. Had my meditation advanced to new heights, I wondered. I was thinking to myself, this feels so real, until I realized to my horror it actually was. I had no idea what was carrying me, but this thing was so huge, and I was powerless to free myself from its powerful grasp. Imagine being pinned under a forklift truck and being unable to move or break free from its formidable hold. This is exactly what it was like for me. I don't believe I screamed. People often think when you're terrified that that is exactly what you will do. But sometimes you don't. In my case, I was so shocked that no words actually came out of my mouth. The next thing I knew was that the creature was running through the forest at such an impressively fast speed, crashing thunderously through the trees like a charging elephant, and pressing the leaf litter under its powerful feet like a mighty pestle and mortar. It seemed this thing was moving like a freight train, bouncing on the vegetation like a trampoline. I could feel the rise and fall of the Bigfoot's chest, and hear her heavy breathing. Then it hit me. I had been abducted by a Bigfoot. Was this really happening to me? The Bigfoot finally put me down, behind a tree, where I slipped beneath the creeping shrubbery, so my body dropped to the ground on a mattress of soft leaves. I stared up into this human-looking face. I could sense almost at once that this Bigfoot was very simple, with the demeanor of a 4-year-old child, even though she was fully grown. I got the sense that she was somewhat retarded. Her head was an odd shape, almost as if she was born with water on the brain or something. She began to play with me as if I was a doll, touching my skin, playing with my hair. "Please, please let me go," I begged her. She dropped her head to one side, with a bewildered look on her face. She was startled that I'd actually spoken to her. There are no words to describe how frightened I felt at this moment. I was so paralyzed with fear, I could barely move a muscle. My body had become rigidly stiff and unobliging. All of a sudden I heard a voice that seemed to be calling out to this Bigfoot that had abducted me. Nika! Nika! Noko la pita! Nika! Nika! I realized someone was calling the Bigfoot, who was obviously named Nika. The female Bigfoot looked alarmed. She tried to remain quiet, indicating for me to do the same. She was behaving like a naughty, mischievous child that was scared of getting into trouble from her parents. It was then that I realized that this was my moment for rescue. I cried out at the top of my lungs, "Help me! Please help!" Seconds later, another female Bigfoot came charging over to where I was lying on the ground. Nika looked alarmed. The large female Bigfoot saw me with Nika. I realized at once she was Nika's mother. She gave the simple Bigfoot a big piece of her mind. The tone of her voice was belligerently angry. She was pointing at me and Nika, as if to say, "What have you done?"
Kilati lako! Hompati! Hakisakana twa! Hopolitana! Ikelepa! Hatolopo! Hakisakwa!
I promise you she sounded exactly like a furious mother who has lost her patience with her daughter, having been caught shoplifting. In this case, her daughter had shoplifted me from the beach. I had no idea what she was saying, because the language she was speaking to her daughter was not one I'd ever heard before. But this large female Bigfoot, whose head shape was perfectly normal, and who was clearly very emotionally intelligent, was not impressed with her daughter for abducting me. Nika hung her head in shame, looking sheepishly bashful. She knew she'd done a bad thing. Nika's mother was pointing accusingly at her, shaking her head. Nika did look ashamed and said something to her mother, which I imagine was sorry. I didn't mean to do it kind of thing. What happened next startled me, because the mother Bigfoot, who was the same height as Nika, turned her attention to me, and this time when she spoke, her words became like English in my head. Although they weren't English, it was like she had spoken to me telepathically.
Kila tinapo, hasikatala, okolosono po, hisatila sinasha, hakolosono.
I'm sorry, Nika's not right in the head. She's got problems. She's grown up but has a mind of a child. She's very sorry for scaring you. I watched as the mother Bigfoot grabbed Nika by the hand. They both glided away. It took me a while to process what had happened to me, as I staggered back to my feet, running across the ribbon of beach to get home. And who should be sitting on the yoga mat, crying like a blubbering baby, but Jackie Bourdain herself. I stood there in bemusement, staring at her, and when she looked up at me she said,
"Oh my God, June! I'm so relieved to see you! You're all right! You're in one piece! I saw the Bigfoot running off with you! I was sure you were dead!"
She ran into my arms. We both lovingly embraced. And since that day, there has never been a bad word between the two of us. Me and Jackie have now become the very best of friends. I hasten to say when I do my yoga exercises, I wait until it's full light, and Jackie always joins me. I enjoy living with her so much. So much so, in fact, that Justin and I have moved into Jackie's place permanently. We couldn't envisage a better lives for ourselves. And my little boy Adam loves having his grandmother around. As for my encounter with the Bigfoots, it is something that me and Jackie have chosen to keep secret. Some things are best kept under wraps, after all. I'm glad to say these days Jackie has cast away her pretentious attitude. She's now doing little things that make life so much more special. She tells me that it has opened her eyes to what really matters in life. So there you are. That's my story.
Wow, what an extraordinary story. I really enjoyed that one. Until next time, goodbye and good night.